Okay, welcome to another episode of IT Idiots. I'm Nicholas Hill, and I'm joined as usual by our legendary trainer, Nicky Curtis.
Hello.
And Shabby Nakfi is thankfully back again with us after a week away. Okay, so for this episode, we've decided to change things around a little bit and change the numbering system. We've decided to use binary, and this now allows us to be able to call this our 100th episode. If you're not too sure what binary is, you're going to learn all about it, and you'll understand why this is our 100th episode. And Nicky will be teaching us all about that this week. So I guess let's start with asking Shabby, what have you been up to this week?
I'm in the world of... Why weren't you here last week?
Yeah.
Late night at work, so I had a couple of deliveries to do because there was a couple of people...
Deliveries? What, babies?
No, just medicine deliveries.
Okay, so nothing very interesting.
I'm afraid no.
I noticed we had a posting on the website, so sort of... assuming that you were out on a hot day. Oh no, that was me. I was trying to big you up, I think, on the website. So yeah, you weren't delivering babies, you were out on a hot date with some chick. So what have you been up to in the world of IT this week, shall we?
Have you done any revision? Have you sold anything on eBay?
No.
You've basically done nothing, have you?
No, I tidied up my room. I've boxed everything that I need to sell on eBay.
And do you think that's going to be of interest for these people? Can you do something IT related perhaps for next week?
Okay. So, Nicky, I'm going to ask you what you've been up to in the world of IT.
Actually, in the world of IT, not a great deal. I'm continuing to work on quite a large Active Directory design.
Okay.
So I had a chance to go down to Brighton, which is kind of nice. Other than that, I've been catching up on TV. So, watching The Apprentice, watching Prison Break.
Where are you up to on Prison Break?
Prison Break, I'm up to episode 20, I think. Is it 20 or 19?
I've seen 19. Okay, sounds pretty good.
So that's about as, well, I suppose it's semi-IT related.
Okay.
Well, I had to get it somewhere, didn't I?
Okay, well, in the world of IT, I guess a lot of my IT work this week has been revolved around this show, moving the show on.
You've done a lot of work on the website?
Yeah, I did a bit of work on the website. I've put a few bits and bobs together. We've got some show notes, got a homework section, which I guess you'll talk about a bit more later on. And... Just generally adding a bit more content. So if you go to the website, you can actually find something, hopefully, of some use and start contributing. I think I'd like to give a personal thank you to Timothy Drew. He sent us, well, he gave us some great feedback on the website, but you didn't register, Timothy. And so that I was a bit disappointed about. So Timothy had a couple of questions, which I think we'll get onto a little bit later on and try and give him some answers to. What else have I been up to? I've been doing a bit of work with trying to get some sponsors for the show. Had a bit of
How's
luck.
How's it going?
Yeah, it's going not too bad. I'm in talks with a few people, and I'm hoping to have a few things sorted out by next week. So hopefully we should have some sponsorship, and that will allow us to start offering those high-quality downloads that we've been promising you for 2 weeks now. But as I say, hopefully this show will possibly even go out in high quality. But we're working on sponsors, and so I hope to give you a little bit more of an update on that next week.
Cool.
So, yes, that's really what I've been up to this week. Okay, yeah, coming back to Timothy. Timothy had a couple of questions. And the first one I'm going to ask is, Nicky, I'd like you
what?
To...
Ooh. Go on.
Timothy asked if you could expand a little bit more on your qualifications and whether you're actually qualified to be able to present this show. He felt that you were. He felt the quality was good, but he just wanted to know what your qualifications were.
Well, I've got 8 GCSEs, English included, although I did fail English the first time round. A bit of a scientific brain, not really my one for reading.
D to F.
D to F, yeah. See, give me numbers, I can work with that. No, but more seriously, in terms of industry qualifications, I mean, I've got the lot. I don't want to just read them out because they are fairly meaningless. As you probably met an MCSE at work at some point who knows absolutely nothing, so I don't brag about them too much apart from now. So what have I got? I started off with Nobel, so where I was qualified as Certified Nobel Engineer, 3, then moved on to 4, 5 and 6, and I've left it pretty much behind on that front. In terms of Microsoft qualifications, I think I qualified as MCSE in NT4, probably about 97, something like that, so
okay.
Pretty much one of the first ones, moved on through 2000, and so in terms of exams, I've done a lot of them. It doesn't mean I'm ultra bright in them, it just means, you know, I'm quite interested and geeky in lots
you've,
of products.
You've learned how they work and what to learn in order to take those exams and pass them with 2 days worth of study.
I looked at my exam score reports actually, and I was going to hoik them out for today, and I counted through them, there's about 47 of them, so I've taken 47.
I might be able to take a couple of snapshots, scan them and put them on the website for people to look at.
Yeah, it's not very exciting at all actually, but there you go.
Come on, let's get on to the good bit though. You're
MCT, CCNA. So a little bit of Cisco work, certified internet webmaster, not sure if that counts anymore.
But you train trainers as well.
And I have trained trainers in the past. I've given a few Microsoft technical presentations, mainly to do with security when Service Pack 2 came out for Windows XP. I did a lot of work with them on that. Also delivered a few webcasts, and I'm getting uncomfortable already, so let's move on.
Okay. Well, I guess it's only fair that Nicky's talked about himself.
Yeah, because Nick, we've just been referring to Nick as the baker. I mean, we know you're a pharmacist, so let's move over you. But Nick, we've referred to you as a baker a few times, and it's not strictly true, is it?
No, it's not quite true. I worked in the city, as I think I said, in the first podcast. So my background is as a software developer, working on sort of client networking, software architecture, started very much in the early days. Developing our business applications so that the banks can use those, using a thin client end with obviously all the back end work going on our servers, SQL Server. So huge amount of development knowledge in that. Well, I like to think so anyway. ISAPI, C++, MFC, all the good hardcore stuff that your real developers use.
No, none of this, none true of this. IT geek really, programming wise, really.
I do like it. I think since I've known you, I've sort of always been playing around with programming in Assembler, C++, and all of those geeky sort of languages. But I decided to give all that up about 5 years ago. I set up a company, and we do high-end edible imaging. I got that in just for you, Dad. I like to refer to myself as a baker, but he was saying that I need to big myself up a little bit.
Well, do you want to mention your website? Is that something you
I can do, yeah. People can go and take a look. It's www.decoent.com. And we provide high-end edible imaging. I guess to you guys that means pictures on cakes, the kind of stuff that you probably see in the supermarkets.
Anything you can download, that opens up so many possibilities. Anything you can get out of the internet, you can basically print it out, put it on a cake and eat it.
Chocolate, any sort of edible substrate, we can pretty much cater for putting imaging onto. So yeah, we provide all the technology for that, the edible substrates, the edible inks, so... It's a bit of a change, but it allows me to be my own boss and to have a go at not actually being given orders, but sit around thinking, bloody hell, this is a bit harder than I thought running a company. So that's what I do, and that's why we refer to me as the baker. So it's I guess that pretty much answers your question, Timothy. So I think probably now's a good time to move on to actually what we're going to cover this week, and I'm going to hand over to you, Nicky, for that.
Yeah, I mean, we've had lots of feedback that... been telling us what we're following is fundamentally quite a good idea, you know, in terms of the domain controller aspect. So if you've been watching the first three episodes, what we've done is episode one, we talked about domains and work groups. Episode two, we had a look at, installing our first domain controller. Episode three, which you didn't bother turning up for, we installed our second domain controller, which was in Ashford. And we also disabled your user account as well.
We pretty much destroyed Dudley.
Yeah, so not sure what we did about Dudley, to be honest. But that's what you've missed. Now, the idea was to get Shabby really knowledgeable about IT systems, in particular corporate IT systems, so that's the idea. Now, he knows next to nothing about IT. You can install a domain controller, but we have been talking a lot about DNS, IP addresses and default gateways, and I think what we need to do is just step back a little bit to give Shabby a little bit of a grounding into the sort of basics of networking.
That sounds like a good idea. I mean, we did actually get some feedback sort of saying to us, hey, you know, SMS, that's great, but, well, let's put the brakes on a little bit. And we got a bit,
we're quite enthusiastic. We were trying to get things out there. And we know we can do a good job with SMS, but perhaps, you know, we ought to get some groundwork in there first.
Yeah, it was a good point you made.
That's a very good point as well.
And basically, the point that was made was, you know, a lot of people are coming into IT now, and they want to get straight into the good stuff, but they go into it without the proper grounding and the understanding of, you know, things, all the back tools that really make your life easy, being able to go forward, those groundings. So I think you're going to cover those this week, aren't you?
Some of them. Indeed. So I'm just going to start off by just showing this picture. What you can see in front of us, we've got our three machines, our three laptop machines. So I've got my little IBM, Chevy, you've got your
Advent 7016.
Advent 7016, bought from Blackdown Pub. And you've got a reasonable little Sony Vaio thing there, haven't you?
Yeah.
And all we've done, we've arranged them as per the diagram which you're seeing at the moment. So three machines on the network, nothing else at the moment. And I've just given them static IP addresses. Now, the only thing I talked about in terms of IP addressing yesterday, in the previous episodes, was the fact that it was an identifier, much like a phone number. Mm. So the idea of today is just to have a look at these three machines, have a look at their identifying IP address, and have a look at how they communicate with one another. So we've just got a very, very small network, totally separate from the rest of the world, with these three machines on them. So the first thing I'm going to do is just work out what the IP address of these three machines are. So this is for you guys to follow as well. What we're going to do is we're just going to go into a command prompt. Now, there's various different ways of getting into a command prompt. You're actually in there, Shabby, at the moment, so we'll leave you there. I'm going to go into a command prompt by doing start run CMD. Okay, and it's quite a quick way to get there. Now, the command we're going to have a look at first is just ipconfig. So this is where you need to write it. You need to do it. Stop taking notes. So ipconfig. So what ipconfig is doing, now there are many switches to ipconfig, we're not worried about that, we're starting on the basics first. It's just showing us our IP address, our subnet mask, and our default gateway. Now, none of us have got a default gateway configured, we've got an IP address and a subnet mask.
Nope.
So, going back to this wonderful diagram here, I've just drawn them out, and we can see I'm over on the left-hand side with 192.168. Oh, where's my pen gone? 192.168.1.151, so that's me. And I'm just going to put a Y in there. That's Nikki with the Y. This is Shabby in the middle, 192.168.1.152. So he's S for Shabby. And a Nick over on the right-hand side is 192.168.1.153. So I'm going to put N for Nick in there. See the way I planned ahead there with the Y?
Yeah, you got it all the wrong way around, though, because when I put over the video, we're all going to be arse about face. But hey, you know, just a little tip for you going forward when you start teaching other people, and perhaps in a real world scenario when you start teaching people.
Right, no, can't work that out. Go.
I feel that you're going to make my life really difficult now.
Okay, well that's our IP address, and as I'm sitting, it looks fine. As you're sitting, you should be able to work it out. YFN. Well, that's almost like a fashion thing. You've said no. Doesn't work out, does it? You silly, no. Anyway, what I'm going to do, let's get techie a bit. I'm going to go into a command prompt, and we know my IP address here is 192.168.1.151.
Yep.
And I'm just going to test to see whether this machine can communicate with, first of all, Shabby's machine, and then with Nick's machine. Now, the command you've all probably used before is ping. So I'm going to type in ping 158. Sorry, that was, it lodged in my memory from work last week. 192.168.1. What's your IP, Shabby?
152.
152. And we can see I'm getting a response from it, so that's looking fine. Next thing I'm going to do is just ping Nick. And again, I'm getting a response from Nick as well. So our machines are definitely communicating with one another. I mean, you guys could ping me to test communication, but to be honest, ping's a two-way process.
Yeah, exactly. You wouldn't have got a reply
if you weren't actually on the network.
Latency's pretty low as well, I'm noticing there as well.
It's pretty good, yeah. It's not too bad at all. It all being on one network and all. Now, if we go back to the IP address again, we notice that what I do have and what you'll have is you've got an IP address and a subnet mask.
Okay.
And what we're going to do is find out what that subnet mask is actually about. Now, the IP address 192.168.1.151, it's an identifier on the network. So it needs to be unique within the scope of the network, and it is in here. Now, we don't have any other networks to communicate with at the moment, it's just us three alone. But if there was a network next door, they would have to have a different network address, so they would have a different unique identifier. The first thing I want to do is find out how we can work out what network these machines are on, and what the host identifier of this machine, of these machines are.
Okay.
So much like when you have a look at a telephone number, you have an area code at the start, network address, and the rest at the end is your host address. It's your identifier within that area.
Mm-hmm.
So nested in that IP address, 192.168.1.151, we've got the host address and we've got the network address. And we need the subnet mask to be able to divide the IP address into both of those portions. Right, you ready for a bit of binary?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Now, if you do know IP, you might think, well, why am I going into binary straight away? I really think if you drop into binary and understand the basics using complicated methods like binary, you're really giving yourself a true understanding of it. And I almost guarantee that you'll find things later on a lot easier. In fact, I'll demonstrate that by the end of this podcast, and I'll give you a split subnet mask, and I pretty much guarantee you'll be able to solve it.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So what we want to do is, so what is an IP address? What is an IP address? It's an identifier on the network. Oops. And we know things about the IP address. We know it contains a network address and a host address. And we use the subnet mask
to break that down and work out which is which.
The IP into network and host. And we do that by anding them together. But before we go into that, let's go back to the first question, what is an IP address? Now we know it's an identifier on the network.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have a look at that identifier, it's a 32-bit number. Now, you've got any idea what that means, Shelby?
I don't.
Okay, there's 32 bits of the number. Now,
I do.
Well, you're a programmer, you probably should know. There's 32 bits to that number, and we're talking about in binary bits. So if we wrote that number down, or IP address, it'd just be a string of ones and zeros.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, 32 ones and zeros. However, what we do is we break those 32 ones and zeros into a grouping of 4 8 bits.
Okay. Yep.
So when we have a look at an IP address, it might look something like this. Whoops.
Has anyone got a copy of Mavis Beacon Learn to Type that they could send in to Nikki?
Okay, so that could be that could be an IP address. However, when you write it down, we like to think of it we break it down into groups of four. So 1, 2, 3, 8. That's the next 8 bits. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, and that's purely for our convenience. I mean, the computer sees it's the 32-bit numbers. The dots are for our benefit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just purely for our benefit. And it just means that we can write that 32-bit number in base 10.
A human-readable form, basically.
Oops. .0.255.0. And that, in actual fact, is that rather strange illegal IP address that I've just formed. Don't worry about that. We're just looking at the maths at the moment. Right, so what that means, what's your IP address, Shelby?
My IP address is 192.168.1.152.
So what we're going to do, first of all, is just convert these numbers into binary. Okay, it may seem like a long way around, but there is a point to this. So I want to find out what 192 is in binary.
Do you have an easy way of doing that? Something that you can teach us?
I do indeed, yeah. 168 in binary. So we need to find out all of these are. 1 in binary. Shelby, do you know what 1 in binary is?
1.
Hey! And 152 in binary. Because the way the subnet mask splits up the IP address into the network and the host portion is by using something called AND, or using a logical AND gate. Okay, now ANDs work on having two inputs. Based upon the relevant input, they have a corresponding output. Okay. So there's quite a lot we're delving into straight away. So, let's just remind ourselves of an AND gate. We said the IP address and the subnet mask, this is not very well drawn, equals the network address. Now when you have a look at an AND gate, AND takes two corresponding inputs. Now those inputs are either 0 or 1, on or off, true or false. Okay, you can say other ways. I use on or off. So going into the AND gate, we could feed an off and an off. That's what both the inputs could be. Or we could feed that one could be off, that one could be on, that one could be on, that could be off. or they both could be on. Yeah, you got that?
Mm-hmm.
So what we're saying is we're feeding two inputs in, and based upon those inputs we get a corresponding output. Now the output of an AND gate only evaluates to on if both the inputs are on. Okay, so that's off, that's off,
mm-hmm.
that's off. So that's off, that's on, off. They both need to be on, so that need to be on, hence the AND.
Mm.
Okay, so 1 and 0 is?
0.
And 1 and 1 is?
1.
1. Okay. So that's one thing you desperately need to know. That if you know that, you're halfway there. You really are. It's all based on the AND gate. There's so many shortcut ways to doing this, guys. What I'm doing is going the long way to try and give us some understanding of it. And to show off. Okay. So let's go back to our document, and what do we say? We said your IP address is 192.168.1.152.
Mm-hmm.
What's your subnet mask, Shebby?
255.255.255.0.
So basically what we need to do is if we get 192 and we AND it with 255, that will give us the first portion of the network address. If we get 168 and it with 255, then we get that portion of the network, etc. So what we're going to do now is AND all of these together. Now there are quicker ways, Nick. I can see you've got your calculator out already in binary mode. but we're not going to go through that yet because I want to lead up into that point. So we're going to convert into binary. Now, as I said, I don't think you're going to learn binary from watching this podcast. This is more of a refresher on binary.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, a lot of people in IT will have touched upon it.
I mean, you've done binary at school, did you?
No.
Didn't you?
No.
But we had a really exciting weekend in once, and I think I taught you binary at the table, didn't I? That's how full our lives are. In fact, you could almost say that once to do a podcast on IP addressing is almost like a cry for help, isn't it?
I wasn't there on that weekend, I really must stress that.
We did hex and everything.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's write Shabby's IP address down now. 192.168.1.152. The subnet mask is 255.255.255.0. Now, we work on each octet. Octet grouping of 8 bits, so that's an octet there. Whoops, I've crossed it out a little bit. So all we're going to do is we're going to AND 192 AND 255.
Nicky, you said you're grouping octets, aren't you?
Yeah, octets. If you look at the IP address, how many bits is an IP address?
4.
No, bits in total. How many binary bits?
32.
32. Mm-hmm. And what do we do? We break it up into 4.
8 bits.
Yeah, so an octet, 8, is 8 bits. Octet, octopus, 8 legs, that kind of thing.
Okay.
Octagon.
Has that got 8 sides? I would imagine so.
I would imagine so as well.
4 8 bits, okay.
So what we're going to do now is convert 192 and 255 into binary so we can AND them together. And if you just watch through, I think this will come clear what I'm actually up to. Now there's a number of ways of writing in binary, of converting into binary. But if you think about an 8-bit binary number, well there's 8 bits in it, and what I'm doing here is I'm writing down the value of those bits. 16... 8.
Makes basically sense, a simple table, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just a table. And let's just use paint. You don't need flash packages, do you?
Yeah.
That's what you need is paint. Just making this a little bit clearer for you guys. And if you just drop this table down, start of your exams, your MCSE exams, just put this table down and you can work out anything from here. Loads of troubleshooting can be solved from this. This is a work of art. Okay, what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to copy that. That would be clever, wouldn't it? And then you don't have to watch me do that again. Okay, so 192, what's that in binary? Now the way I do it is I just work from the left-hand side to the right-hand side to start with here, and I just ask myself these questions. Okay, I want to represent 192 in binary. So, there's 128 in that, isn't there?
Definitely.
So that bit's got to be set to 1. You've got to... Okay, is there a 64 left? 128 plus 64, what's that equal?
182.
Mm-mm.
Nah.
Add on the last two digits from each side, last digit from each side.
It's basically like addition. You take 128 and you add 64 to it. It's quite hard. this addition thing.
If I've got 128 tablets and I add 64 tablets...
192.
192.
Exactly.
You're actually right.
That's what I did.
Well, I don't know.
No, I think playing back to, yeah, I can say.
So all the rest can be set to zero, can't they? Shall we?
Yes, that's right, sorry.
Pay attention. So that's 192. Mm-hmm. Agree with that. Right, then we're going to take 255 and convert 255 to binary. Now, 255, again, just to save a little bit of time, I'm going to go through this. 255, you only need to convert once, ever, in your life to binary. Do you know what 255 is in binary, Shabby? Okay, too many pauses. Let's put it together. Okay, so...
Is there 128 in it?
So, what? Add them up. 128, what's that? 192, what's that? 224, 240, 248, 252, 254, 255.
Ta-da!
I've done that before. So 255, don't ever work that out in binary again. All the 8 bits are set to 1. Okay?
Well, just right. Memorise that.
Let's memorise it. And let's add them together. 128. Sorry, what am I saying 128? What's 1 and 1, Shabby?
1.
1. Okay. What's 60? What's 1 and 1 there?
1.
1. What's 0 and 1?
0.
0. What's 0 and 1?
0.
0. What's 0 and 1?
0.
0.
0
and 1. Next one?
0.
0. Zero.
Eight.
What's that number equal?
It's coming.
You don't need to look far. Maybe two
maybe
lines
just
above.
Just miss a line, go above.
What does that equal? So look, there's 128. There's a 64 in it.
What's that equal? 192.
192. Right. Is there anything strikey about that number?
Same as the original number.
Exactly, it's the same as the original number. So if you add 192 with 255, you get 192 out of it. That's easy. Let's go through another one, even though this is totally pointless, and I think most people have got this now, but just to prove a point, and to prove for Shabby as well. Remember, he's a little slower than most. What are we going to do?
Just going to alter that number slightly.
I'm just going to very, very quickly just...
That's right, I can edit if you need to.
Do. People will see the way I do this.
It's quality, you know.
It's quality. That would do. So let's work on the next octet. 168 and 255. Can you give me a guess at the answer? So I'll take 168.
Oh, 168.
Hey. Somewhere. Well, again, let's just prove prove your binary skills. Let's go through that. Right, 168, what is it?
That's quickly,
128.
Yep.
Another what? One?
No.
No, because that would be 192, wouldn't it? So we have none of them. Okay, next off.
Zero.
One of those.
Yeah.
That's 160, isn't it now? 128, yes, yeah. 32, 160. 160. None of them.
No.
One of them. 168. None of those. Mm-hmm. None of those. We've got the number, haven't we? So that's 168. Mm. And you can obviously take it if you add that number with that down the bottom. I mean, you're going to get... Well, you get 168. I don't really need to do that, do I?
No, I think okay. I think shabby.
So far, we know the network address is 192.168. One? Yeah. Okay. So, we don't need to and anything with 255 now, because we know if we and something with 255, we get what we're anding it with. What about if we and something with 0? What do you reckon? 152 and 0. What's 0 in binary?
Zero.
Now, if you think about the AND gate, what we drew up, I don't know if you've got it in front of you still, but if there's zero anywhere in the outputs, you get zero out of it. So it's quite obvious, if you AND anything with zero, you get zero. Likewise, if you AND anything with 255, you get what you're ANDing it with. So we never need to work that out again. Right. Let's go back to the document here. So, Shabby, that was your IP address, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Oh no, you've taken us off air. Sorry about this, all very professional.
What happened?
I think I've referred to us as bloody professional before. I think we're still bloody professional.
Okay, so that's your IP address, that's the subnet mask. Tell me what your network address is, shall we?
Just worked it out.
We just worked it out.
Off the top of your head. Come on, let's fire this off, let's keep this punchy.
Come on, it's got to be punchy, people said it's boring. third episode, so it was good. That's the one you weren't in.
Yep. They loved it. The ratings went up through the roof.
You're fighting for your position.
Ratings went through the roof.
192 and 255.
It's 192.
192. Okay. Next off, 168 and 255.
Sorry, 168.
168. Okay, 1 and 255.
It's 1.
1. Okay, 152 and 0.
It's 0.
You've done it.
Okay.
For you have sinned. Host address. Oh, we haven't seen the host address. So that's your network ID, 192.168.1. And we all share that, otherwise we wouldn't be able to communicate with one another with our current configuration. So the host address, to be honest, is everything that's left. Okay, so what's left? And I think what I'm going to do is just write this down. The host address is actually equal to the IP address minus the network address.
That sounds like quite a good way.
That's a good way to think about it at the moment, because, again, when you get into split subnets, that's still true.
Mm-hmm.
Still true. Okay. So, what we need to do, and I'll write this out for you, Shelley, because I know you need all the help you can get. That's your IP address. Yeah. Mm-hmm. This is the network address, which we've just worked out. Okay, take them away.
152.0.0.0.152.
That's correct. Now, you don't put 0.0.0.152 for the simple, well, I don't say I'm 00033 years old. You know, you just lose the most significant bits. There's no point in saying that.
So maybe we could start a new trend.
We could do. We could. I think we start a trend of my name in binary, my name in binary, my age in binary.
Okay.
That's good, isn't it? Which is 10. That's okay.
But that'll go down well at parties.
It will do.
Make you the belle of the ball.
Ooh. Right. So that's it. Yeah. Right. What's next? Let's go through another couple of examples. 192.168.168.mavis.5.201.
Ooh.
Right. There you go, Shabby, and the rest of you guys. So the host address, so we've got a machine out there whose IP address is 192.168.5.201.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the subnet mask on that machine is 255.25.
It's 192.168.5.201.
Yeah. Yeah.
Exactly
right. It's easy, isn't it? Host address is? It's 201 minus 0. It's minus quite a hard one. Thank you. And I mean, what you could do is add them back up. You should get to the IP address.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so all of that's quite straightforward, isn't it? In fact, it's almost easy. Right, one more. 158.158.1.53.255.255.255.0. Of course, I said something different to what I typed. So what I meant is what I typed. So the IP address is 158.152.1.53. The subnet mask is 255.255.0.0. We're really drilling at home, guys. Sorry if you know this already, but we're getting to it in a minute. Right, network address.
158.
Yep.
152.
Yep.
0.
Yep.
0.
Exactly right. What's the host address?
0.
Yeah, you can put them in.
Oh, sorry,
it's
53.
Is it? No, it isn't.
Oh,
hang on. See, that's what everyone does wrong. Everyone does that wrong, you know. It's absolutely amazing. Everyone
but then that's why I think it was fair that he was going to go along. I think if he'd gone along and done the zero, and I think if he'd done the numbers up above, one above each other.
Well, the thing is, I think we tend to pay too much attention to the dot. You've got to remember when the computer's doing all of this, it's just a string of 32 ones and zeros. He hasn't got a clue what the dot is. The dot's for our convenience. That's what it is. So, you know, if you get confused, which you're going to do, Shabby, just write them one under another. You know, we worked out that the network address of that was 158.152.0.0, and then we could just minus them out, so 0.0.1.53. That's the host.
Yeah, I think that's a nice, easy way of doing it, certainly when you're getting started.
Yeah. I mean, there's only a couple of rules in this. We know that the network address is the IP address and the subnet mask.
Mm-hmm.
The host address is the IP address minus the network address. And that's it. Simple as that. Okay. What I'm going to do now is something really quite exciting. You ready for it, Shelby?
Go for it.
Thank you. Right, so we can see the IP address of my machine. It's 192.168.1.151. I'm now going to ping 192.168.5.200. Okay, and hit return on that. Now, you might have used ping before. Have you used ping before, Shelby?
You explained it earlier on.
A little bit. What do you think I'm going to get back? Or Nick, what do you think I'm going to get back from this?
I would imagine it's not going to find anything.
Not going to find anything. Now, the network I drew earlier was correct, you know, the one with the three machines, the Y, S and N, that's our network. So there isn't, that machine doesn't exist on the network. Let's hit return and see what happens. Now, some of you might guess request timed out. Some of you might guess destination not found or destination host unreachable. Now, we're actually going to get here destination host unreachable immediately. Right, and what we need to do now is find out, well, how does it know it's not reachable? How did it go through that? Right. You're keeping up. Is this good stuff?
I'd imagine. Are you asleep? Wait, wake up!
Wake up. Okay. Oh, it's good this is. Right, so what, what we're going to do is have a look at my machine. And let's just say this machine here. I'll just move it up to the top, Nick. That might make it easier for you, might that?
Yeah, that'd be nice.
Okay. And my address is 192.168. 1.151. My subnet mask is 255.255.255.255.255.0. Okay, now we worked out what my network address is, and we all should be fairly capable of doing that now. It is 192.168.1.1. Spot the deliberate mistake. Okay, 1.0. Right, copy time. Nick, what have you been into it?
I've already covered that. Come on, get back to it. I want to know more about IP addresses.
Okay, and what I just did is I just typed in ping.
Ping.
192.168.5.something.
This is carefully scripted to for him to make these mistakes.
We've done
I'm telling
so,
you.
So much planning. It's unbelievable.
Crazy.
Okay, 200. And what did I get back? Destination host unreachable. Now, it didn't even try and get anywhere. It just knew immediately I can't get there. And some of you realise why it knew that. It's because it hadn't got a default gateway.
Mm-hmm.
But how did it realise that this wasn't on its network? Now, this machine knows what network it's on. Okay, it knows it's on 192.168.1.0. Okay, it knows that because it's got its IP address, it's got its subnet mask. That's the only thing it needs.
Mm-hmm.
And when it goes to ping 192.168.5.200, the first question it asks us is something very... It asks itself is something very, very straightforward. Is the destination local or remote? I.e., is it on this subnet, only us three are on this subnet, or is it somewhere else?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if it's somewhere else, it's going to try and get to that somewhere else, forward it to its default gateway, etc. Okay. So how does it do that? Bearing in mind, all the information it's got is the IP address of the thing we're pinging, which is 192.168.5.200. It needs to work out if that's local or remote. How do you think it does that? What about you, Nick? Have you got any idea? It's not immediately obvious, I wouldn't say. It needs to find out the network address of that destination. It needs to find out the network ID of 192.168.5.200.
So is it going to use the host address part?
Not quite. It's just asking itself one question at the moment. Is it local or remote? So in order to answer that question, it needs to find out the network address of the remote host we're pinging. How does it do that?
Network address of the remote host it's pinging...
Because when you ping something, you don't say, I'm going to ping this machine, and by the way, this is its default gateway. You don't say, you know, this is the default gateway the web server wants to get to. You just give the IP address.
Hmm.
So it's got to use someone's default gateway. You actually use your own default gateway.
Ah, so it does the math with itself.
Exactly. So what my machine actually did is it said, okay, I want to get to the machine 192.168.5.200. I'm going to apply my subnet mask to the destination and we work out it's on the network 192.168.5.0.
It says no, I'm having none of that.
Exactly. It knows it's on the network 192.168.1.0, so it says can't get there. What we're going to do now, before we progress, I just want to give you guys some questions to go through. Now, these questions are going to be available on the website, so you can download those from the website. But what I'm going to do is I'm just going to jot them out here now, just so to give Shabby something to
do. We don't want to make them downloadable only.
Yeah, come to the website.
Yeah, come to the website. We want to get a few people over to the website. We want to get some more feedback, some votes, and try and get you interactive as build us up as a community. So
okay, so the first set of questions, which I haven't generated as yet, what are they? But I'm going to give you an IP address and a subnet mask. What I want you to do is work out the host address and the destination address.
Okay, well, I've done my homework. How have you done with yours, Shabby?
I like what you've done here. You're sort of getting it. Yeah, it's not bad. Not bad at all. Anyway, guys, you'll find that homework on the website. We're basically trying to get you to come to the website. So the homework's on the website. And basically what it is an IP questions. It'd be really good if you can follow it. It is going to get more advanced from week to week. So if you keep up with it, you will truly understand that. You will truly understand firewalls. It's going to be great.
You can come and join our weekend then.
And if you think I've made any mistakes or you think there's a better way of explaining it, which I doubt.
Then keep it to yourself.
Post to the forum. Any problems at homework, just post to the forum. Okay, so we did a bit about subnet masks and IP addressing, network and host addressing and blah, basically. What we're going to do is just carry that on a little bit and deal with a subnet mask which doesn't contain all the 255s or zeros, because I don't have to. I mean, it's easy, isn't it? If you end something at 255, Shabby, you know what you're going to get it with. If you end 3,800 with 255, what do you get?
3,800.
Sorry.
Okay. It was a big number you gave him.
Okay. What about 3,700 with zero?
Zero.
Yes. Okay. So, and anything with 255, you get what you're ending with. And anything with zero, you get zero. However, in real life, it's not always that clean. So, what I want you to do is we're going to change our IP addresses. Let me just get rid of this. And I'm going to change my IP address to be 192.168.1.129. Okay, my subnet mask is going to be 255.255.255. You ready for this, Shabby?
Zero.
What's it going to be? No?
No.
240, I think. Now, just a bit of a hint, when you look at a subnet mask in binary, you can tell subnet masks because the form of them in binary, they go all ones and stop and go all zeros. So you can't have a subnet mask like this, 255.0.255.0. Can't do that.
That's an illegal...
It's not a valid subnet mask, you can't do it. It's got to start with ones and go all the way and stop with zero. So, do you want to change your IP address, Shabby, on your machine? You can change your IP address. I'm just giving them some IP addresses. They're going to be 192.168. Shabby, you're going to be .130. Now remember, your subnet mask is 255.255.255.240. You might have to help Shabby out here now.
Do we keep the same IP addresses, boss?
Nope, you're going to be 1.129.
1.129.
No, sorry, you're not. You're going to be 1.131.
It's a crazy world. Right, and a subnet mask, 255.255.255.240.
Yep.
Okay. I'm good to go. Right, go to IP. That's it. Right. Oh, no, don't disconnect it. No. Click select it.
And what I'm doing...
Properties.
I'm just going to go to the properties of my network card, my wireless network
card. What shall be, 130?
He's going to be 130, yeah.
Come down here and change that 0 to a 240. Okay.
And I'm going to be 129. So some of you can start working out what network we're on. So, that's all our IP addresses changed. What I'm going to do is go into a command prompt. I'm just going to try and ping Shabby first.
Yep.
I wonder if this is going to work.
Yeah, I've got a reply from him.
Yep, so Shabby's working fine. And let's ping 192.168.131, which is NIC. And that's working fine. So, again, we're all on the same network. Now, the question is, what network are we on? What's our network address?
You might want to draw up your
I'm going to have to go into binary, but what I do, just to simplify the problem, what we need to do is take 192.168.1.RIP address, I take mine 129, and we AND it with 255.255.255.240. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so what I'm going to do is 192.168.1.129, my IP address, let's put 255 underneath it. And I think sometimes it's nice to do this because you end up simplifying the problem, because I know that the network address is 192.168.1.something. Don't know what the last one is. Okay, but it's obvious to you, Shabby, isn't it, that the first three
is
going to be 192.168.1.something, isn't it? And what we've got to do is take 240 and AND it to 129. Mm-hmm. So, back into binary. Back into paint.
Quick clear, and you've got a paste, I think, still somewhere.
I have, haven't I? So let's okay. Use this. And let's just paste it into here. So, Nick, do you remember what the number was? 129, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's not Philip, it's not paint.
So.
129.
It'd be under 128, it'd be 1.
And you can tell I worked this one out in my head. Okay?
I'm going to keep going with zeros here for a bit.
Keep going. 0, 0, 0.
Stop.
1.
Yes.
Okay, so that's 129, yeah. Right.
240 is the other number we want to reach.
Sorry, I've just lost my pen pointer. There we go. So 240, what's that? Well, there's 128.
Yeah.
That'd be 192.
Yeah.
That'd be 224. That'd be 240. And all of those are going to be set to 0. You agree, shall we?
I do.
Yeah. So just as I was saying, with the subnet mask, we can see that 240, it translates into ones and then stops and goes zeros. You couldn't have a subnet mask which is 241, for argument's sake. It would be invalid. So let's AND them together. Right. Shabby, seeing all the one here, I'm going to drag into the now.
It's a one.
One, yeah.
Zero.
Yeah.
Zero.
Zero. Yeah.
Zero.
Yeah.
Zero.
Yeah.
Zero.
Yeah.
Zero.
Yeah.
Zero.
Okay, what's that equal?
One.
Remember, there's a lookup table.
Oh, 128. Thank you, pardon.
Yeah. So, would we be right in saying then that this machine is on the network 128?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely right. So, we're on the network 192.168.1.128. It doesn't look like a network address, it might look like a host address, but it's not, it's a network address. Right, what's your host address? What's your host address? Now, your IP address is 192.168.1.130.
Yes.
Is that right? Yeah. Your 1318.
Yeah.
Okay. So what's your host address, Shabby?
Something minus something, isn't it?
192.
Okay. IP. Oh, a bit of a caps lock issue going on here. IP address minus the network address. So what's your IP address? 192.168. Go on, keep going.
130.
130. Okay, we just worked out the network address is 192. What?
168.1.
Yeah.
Dot 128.
128. So what's your host address?
2.
Sure.
Oh.
So you're telling me 130 minus 128 is 2, are you?
Yeah.
You're absolutely right.
Cruelty.
Cruelty. You're right. So Nick, your host ID is what?
3
and mine's 1. Now it's as simple as that. So you can see, if you do the basic binary, your subnet mask of 240 or 248 or 192, they're not hard. And what I'm going to do is we're going to put some more exercises on, or some more homework on, up onto the website that deal with these split subnet masks.
Just to get a bit of practice, so people can start doing it off the top of their head rather than having to refer back to the...
Exactly. But, I mean, you can do what I'm doing, just make them up. Just make them up. And if you get familiar with this, you'll really understand IP and understand routing and...
Be able to impress your friends in the office.
Stuff. Right. Now, what I'm going to do, Shabby, this is the culmination of the podcast. I'm going to ping 192.168. I'm going to have to think on this one for a little bit. 1.97. Okay, so I'm going to ping 192.168.1.97.
IP address.
Now, what's the ping result? What's going to come back? Does my machine know how to get there? I mean, what's the first thing this machine's going to have to work out?
Whether there's a subnet mask, isn't it?
Not quite. He knows it's got a subnet mask, so that's wrong. In fact, there's no not quite about it. It's totally wrong. Okay. So I'm being a little harsh. Okay, but we're pinging 192.168.1.97. The first thing we always ask is that local or remote? Okay, and it's an important thing. Is it local or remote? So write that down. How are we going to find out if that's local or remote?
Don't you AND it with the 255?
We AND it with the subnet mask of the client. Yeah. And the subnet mask of the client is 255.255.255.240. Okay. So, we're either going to get a destination host unreachable or a quest timed out. It depends. So, what we're going to work out is that machine, 192.168.1.97, what is the network address of that? Okay. 192.168.1. What was it, 97?
97, yeah.
97. Okay, so is that local or remote?
It's 192.
Remote. So what do? We take our subnet mask. You should be telling me this, Yabby. I'm quite disappointed. 97.
255.255.240.
And then together. Okay.
We AND those together, so we know our subnet mask is 192.168. Sorry, our subnet mask is 255.255.255.240. We AND that to the destination IP address, and we're going to work out that this machine is actually on the network. What's 192.255, Shabby?
192.
What's 168.255?
168.
168. What's 1 and 255?
1.
Yeah, and what's 97 and 240?
In fairness, I think he can go back and do his.
Now, sadly enough, you'll start getting these. Do you know what I mean? You will start getting these. So I know it's 92.
But in fair, no, I think in fairness, for him to go back and do the long-handed calculation would be the way for him to do it.
I'm just trying to gain some stardom. That's what I'm trying to do. Okay, so
just clear it and paste your table.
But I'm the IT professional. Oh, you're a baker, mate.
That's right.
Right. Okay.
A lot of binary in bakery.
This is proving so much. I hope you guys appreciate this. Right. What are we converting?
97 and 240.
So. 97.
Pen.
Am I using the pen or the brush?
Paintbrush.
Okay, 97. None of them. One of them.
Yeah, one of them.
That's 92, isn't it?
Yeah,
none of them. 96.
One of those, yeah.
97. That's 97,
though. Yeah.
No, it's wrong, isn't it?
Might be wrong. Let's try it again. 64, 96. Absolutely right. Right. And I don't like Shabby being wrong.
Sorry, I'm going to edit that
one.
That's right, guys.
Okay, the next one's 240, isn't it?
That's right.
Keep up.
It is. One.
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 Yeah.
One.
Yeah. I just remember, you will remember that 240 is four ones. It's midpoint, yeah. So that way you know that 248 is five ones. Again, you don't need shortcuts, you just need familiarity with this. Okay, right, you're going to AND these for me, Shabby. 0 and 1.
0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0.
What's that?
32 is 96.
I'd make it 96 as well.
I would make it 96, but my assumption when I was trying to be clever early on and say, oh yeah, I've got it, it's 96. You two can shut up, okay? 96.
Making real human again, isn't it?
I think we'll teach him. We'll give you a little refresher course later on.
Right, that's 96. Oh, can we AND this podcast now? It's all going wrong. Right. 96.
Was it?
What's the host address? Shut up. Come on.
The host address is 192.168.
It's quite a hard one. It's 97 minus 96. This one.
One.
Hello, pretty cat. Okay, so that's 0.0.0.1. Right, now, the whole point of this was, what would happen if I ping 192.168.1.97? Does my machine know how to get there? Is that machine local to this network or remote from this network?
It's pinged, isn't it?
It hasn't yet. We want the answer.
We want the answer. So I'm on the network 192.168.1. Well, we're on the network 192.168.1.128, aren't we?
The thing has fallen down.
Don't know. Host unreachable is the answer. Well, that sort of concluded that. The point of this was Chevy's not clever enough to keep up, but hopefully you are. So we ping 192.168.1.97. The point I was trying to make to this is that machine is on the network address 192.168.1.96. I mean, for heaven's sake, we just worked that out, didn't we? Okay. We also just worked out 5 minutes prior to that. You're getting red, dish. 5 minutes prior to that we're on the network 192.168.1.128. So it's different, so we get host unreachable. Therein did the lesson.
God.
Right, so that was a little bit of IP. There will be some homework to follow, and as I said, I am asking a lot of Shabby to get this down in one go, because, I mean, I was teaching this in 5 days on the MCSE, so, you know, we're just having a bit of a laugh, to be honest. But there is some homework available on the website, and there is some split subject masters, some local remote ones, some really good ones out there that will really give you an understanding on how IP works, and we can move forward. And I'll be lurking around on the forum.
Yeah, me too. I've got nothing better to do with my time, so come along and ask us some questions. We're going to add some more to the website. We've got a few more ideas. Obviously, we do this in our spare time, so for me, that's basically 9 to 5, Monday to Friday. But more seriously, we will be adding more content and we're going to try and maintain a blog as well. I'm going to try and get that finished this week, and Nikki and I will try and blog this week, and hopefully you might find some interest in following along with what we get up to over the week. So
it's all been depressing now, isn't it?
Here endeth the lesson.
Here in Seven. Anyway, okay. Dude, I'm glad you're back, because I've been waiting for a couple of weeks with this problem I've been having.
How did you get on with the marathon, by the way?
Marathon didn't go amazingly well, I must admit. I walked up the stairs, I was going to the station to make my way up to London to go running, and I was having a few issues with my feet. Okay. Now, I've been training a lot recently, and I'm getting sort of itchy feet. I would show you, but, well, there is an explicit tag on this podcast, isn't there? But
let's not go there. We don't want to make people ill. They could be watching this whilst having their lunch at work.
But have a look, Chevy, and Nick. It's not too good, is it? It's a little bit manky, and I was just wondering if
it's all black.
Something I could use to sort that out, or, you know,
very red, and
anyone else has got any
I think I know where you're going with this. The bottom line is, you said you didn't get very far.
No, it was a feet pain. I couldn't. I was gutted.
I didn't even go.
Didn't you?
No, I just thought, I'm not doing this.
I thought you were so spot on doing it, Nick.
Well, I was, but I'd been having similar issues.
Really?
Mm. Yeah. I went to get some advice, and I got prescribed this. It's Caniston. I was a bit frightened by this.
Caniston?
Because, yeah, I mean, what little sort of interaction I've had with women, I've always been led to believe this is a woman's issue,
you know,
type drug.
I had a girlfriend once, and I seem to remember that all those many moons ago, I saw a lot of this stuff around, and
anyway, Chevy, so can you explain to us what this is going to do for us, and why you're prescribing a woman's medicine to us men?
Men! This is a cream called Caniston Hydrocortisone. It's a cream used to treat fungal infections of the feet.
Women have got feet.
Women have got feet.
In particular, athlete's foot.
Ah.
And there's a particular condition called candidiasis. We probably know it better as thrush. And that's also used to treat that as well.
So have I got foot thrush?
No, you've got another type of infection called athlete's foot, which is characterised as damp by your toes being a bit damp and a bit itchy in between the second and third toes.
So do we eat this?
No, you don't eat it. You apply.
That's close.
The cream you apply 2 or 3 times a day, but apply thinly and rub in well. It stops the itching after about 7 to 10 days. But what I do recommend is that you keep using the cream for at least a week or two after it clears up, because the itching may go away, but the underlying infection may not.
Okay.
So I'd apply it thinly. So rub it. Apply thinly, but rub in well, 2 or 3 times a day. Make sure that you thoroughly dry your feet in between coming out of a shower, because a wet environment will encourage the fungus to grow.
Okay. And does it vary much for a woman?
If she was suffering from the same condition, no.
The mic's fallen down again. The condition.
After 2 or 3 days.
Okay.
Right.
On that note, Blackleaf's foot, our resident pharmacist Shabby, is prescribing Caniston.
Blackleaf's foot and sweat rash.
I think we'll leave it at that.
I think we should have.
Okay. So that ends another episode. We're hoping that you're still continuing to follow along and that you can recommend this to people still. Yeah, I don't know about after this episode, but we're still hoping. But if you've got any feedback, if you want to come along to the website, we have got some forums going, and it would be great if you would put some postings in there. You can also send us an email to feedback@itidiots.com, and again, our contact details individually are on the website. So any medical issues, send them to Shabby. Again, as it says on the website, the itchier the better, and he'll try and answer some of yours. Me and Nicky can't keep having all these problems every week.
No.
I can't imagine it. So any of your problems, do send us them. But I think on that note, I'm going to end this podcast.
Okay. See you later.
Bye.
Himself to sleep tonight on his huge pillow.